Welcome to the first live broadcast of a court proceeding in Alaska. The gavel is scheduled to come down at 10 o'clock this morning on Williams versus Zobel, case number 5400, from the State Supreme Court chambers in Anchorage. Justices will hear arguments on the constitutionality of the income tax relief and permanent fund dividend programs. This live coverage is being co-produced by Alaska Review and KAKM Television and is being carried by public television stations KTOO in Juneau, KUAC in Fairbanks, KYUK in Bethel, and the Alaska Public Radio Network, which serves the 12 public radio stations in the state. This program is also being made available to all commercial television and radio stations in Alaska as well. The Alaska Public Broadcasting Commission made the arrangements for this program to be transmitted via the state satellite project, which serves nearly 70 communities in Alaska. This is Pete Carran for KAKM. Most Alaskans are familiar with this case by now. There's money on the line. Last June 27th, Anchorage Superior Court Judge Ralph Moody ruled in favor of Ronald and Patricia Zobel's arguments that the state's new income tax relief and permanent fund dividend laws were unconstitutional. And we'll get more into the background of that case in just a few minutes. But first, I would like to introduce the expert we've called on to assist in this production. John Havelock is the Director of Legal Studies for the Justice Center of the University of Alaska in Anchorage. He's practiced law in Alaska for 20 years, has served as the state's Attorney General, and has argued numerous cases before the Alaska Supreme Court. He was the initiator of the cameras in the court program and has been following its progress since its inception in 1978. John, we've touched briefly on the significance of this program, the first live broadcast of an Alaskan court proceeding. In the way of background, can you tell us how the cameras in the court program has evolved to this point?
Sure, Pete. Cameras were not generally banned in courtroom proceedings until a notorious Houtman kidnapping trial back in 1935. That was the Lindbergh baby kidnapping, and the whole nation was alive with interest. Cameras came into that courtroom with the kind of equipment that they had in those days. You may recall the flash that was used with an explosive flash, and the cameraman just walked all over the courtroom. As a result of that and a reaction to it, the American Bar Association and the judicial branch started closing down on cameras in the courtroom and called them unethical. With the advent of modern TV, we have had a renewed interest in cameras in the courtroom. But again, the cameras in the courtroom ran afoul of the excesses of the profession, if you will, and the laxness of some judges. Texas had never adopted the ethical rule. And when Billy Saul Estes, who the older members of the audience may remember is a great grain swindler down in Texas, and his trial was held, and again, the judge didn't control. The media was all over the place, dragging cables and carrying on. The Supreme Court reversed his conviction, characterizing the proceedings as being a circus, a carnival atmosphere. Well, in the late 70s, we've had a renewal of interest in the rule, and a number of states have experimented, and the judges are a little more wary on the one hand of the excesses. On the other hand, there is an increasing consciousness of the importance of informing the public about what's going on in these courtrooms, which tend otherwise to be kind of empty.
Now, there have been three cases that have been broadcast for tape delay to date, right?
Yes, we've had the Byrne Initiative case and the election contest case. The election, both of those were in both the trial court and in the appeals court.
Okay. KAKM's Carroll Hodge talked to State Supreme Court Chief Justice Jay Rabinowitz Wednesday afternoon about cameras in the courtroom.
Do you have any reservations about the use of cameras in a courtroom?
Not at the appellate level. I think it's very educational, it's informative, and it reduces the mystery and the misunderstanding that the public has regarding the functions of the court's highest court in the state of Alaska. So I think I've noticed no difference in the type of oral argument we receive. In other words, I don't think that the attorneys are theatrical because they're being televised. And I don't think the character of the court's questioning has not changed. And our behavior has not been affected by the use of television, nor have counsel in the three prior arguments that we've had. I think once you get into the arguments, and you'll watch this tomorrow, perhaps initially, I know I am initially aware of the camera, but then if the arguments are good, and certainly we have very complex and very interesting issues that are going to be argued tomorrow morning before the Supreme Court, if you're paying attention and the case has substantive issues that are interesting, you're not aware that the camera's there, particularly the equipment today. Your equipment is soundless. It's not like the old type movie cameras where they really made a lot of noise, but we're being photographed right now and you hear absolutely no noise. So it's not distracting.
Income tax relief and permanent fund dividends were spurred by Alaska's great oil wealth, which created a huge state surplus of funds. When the laws were approved by the legislature and signed by Governor Jay Hammond, state lawmakers pointed to the income tax and permanent fund dividend programs as two of the major accomplishments of the last session. The income tax statute repealed the tax for Alaskans who have filed at least three returns. A graduated scale was used for those filing 2 years and less. The permanent fund legislation awarded Alaska residents a dividend for each year they have lived in Alaska since statehood that was set at $50 per year this year. But the programs were jeopardized when the Zobels filed their lawsuit. Ron Zobel was a guest on Byline, a KAKM public affairs program, July 2nd. We asked him about the controversy his challenge of the laws had caused.
Well, I didn't expect it to be a very popular move. But I think that that Alaskans are fair, and I think if they consider the issues and the decision that has been made, that in the end, they're going to place the responsibility where it belongs. And the responsibility for the situation that they find themselves in, and that I find myself in, is with the legislature and the administration, which approved a couple of statutes that were unconstitutional and unacceptable and bad for the people of the state of Alaska and for the future of the state. And I think in the end, the people of Alaska are going to realize that.
Do you have any regrets, I mean, after the fact, any regrets that you filed the lawsuit in view of
some no, of the... none at all, none at all. If I didn't file it, or if my wife and I didn't file it, somebody else was going to. And so the people should not hold us personally responsible. It was going to be filed, and I think it was good that it came at this time so that these issues can be resolved. And hopefully a special session of the legislature can be held either soon or after the Supreme Court decision, and income tax relief will come to all Alaskans and not just to some.
Judge Ralph Moody agreed with the Zobels. In his 17-page opinion, he said of the income tax law as it relates to residency, though this court does not find that the classifications are the equivalent of a durational residency requirement, the classifications do make distinctions between longer-term residents and newcomers. In order to survive judicial scrutiny, the classifications must be reasonable, not arbitrary, and must rest upon some ground of difference having a fair and substantial relation to the object of the legislation. Judge Moody also said of the income tax law, this court recognizes that the state may legitimately reduce or eliminate tax liability for its citizens, but it may not do so in a manner which discriminates against certain classes of its citizens. For these reasons, this court concludes that the tax exemption statute is unconstitutional on its face. Moody then turned to the permanent fund dividend plan, saying, economically favoring one class of residents over another does not serve any compelling state interests, and there are less drastic alternatives available to accomplish the legislative objectives. this court finds that the permanent fund distribution statute is unconstitutional and violative of the Equal Protection Clause of the Alaska Constitution. Judge Moody also said of the permanent fund law, this court finds that the system devised for distribution of income from the permanent fund is not an equitable, non-discriminatory one, and that it is, in the words of Justice Rabinowitz, nothing more than a bonus or reward for having been a resident of Alaska longer than certain other classes of persons.
John, something very interesting there. Judge Moody quotes Chief Justice Rabinowitz. What is Rabinowitz referring to when he makes that statement?
Well, Judge Moody is quoting Rabinowitz from a concurring opinion in Thomas against Bailey, which was the Byrne Initiative homestead initiative lawsuit. In a 4-1 ruling in that case, the initiative was knocked off the ballot on the grounds that the initiative was, in effect, an appropriation, a form of initiative which is prohibited by the Constitution. But the plaintiffs also attacked the durational residency preference, which was established in that statute. That is a provision which said that people that had lived in Alaska longer were entitled to more land than those who had lived here for a shorter period of time. Now, Justice Jay Rabinowitz wrote a concurring opinion in that, agreeing with the majority, but saying that the durational residency preference was also unconstitutional. This is what we call in the trade dictum. That is, it wasn't essential, but it was a signal to for the future. Justice Connor dissented on both of these issues, which may give us some clues as to which way things are going to go later on.
Okay, very quickly, John, this might be a natural place to explain what a trial court, a court like Judge Moody's, does.
Yeah, well, the trial court is the front line of the judicial system. Ralph Moody didn't ask for this case, but when a lawsuit is brought, it's the judge is on the spot, he has to decide it the best he can. Okay. That doesn't mean he expresses his own preference. What he has to do is develop a professional opinion as to which way the appellate judges are going to rule on the issue. That is, he looks at the Supreme Court opinions of the United States and the state and figures out not what his view is, but how they would decide this case.
What about his record of reversal? Judge Moody has been overturned a few times, a celebrated case in the August primary election of 1978.
Well, he did, as you say, he did get reversed on his guess on the primary. It was a tough one, a close one. Most of these cases that come to the Supreme Court are already close. Our lawyers wouldn't be arguing about them if they were all one way or the other. And I don't know whether Ralph Moody has the best record on reversal. He certainly doesn't have the worst. He calls them as he sees them. The court doesn't publish statistics on these things, and to do so would be misleading because there are lots of ways in which a judge, if he was worried about that record, could manipulate it to avoid having a bad reversal record. So it's not a good indicator of performance.
Okay.
Judge Moody is a good judge. He calls them like a good judge should as he sees them.
But we all know the state doesn't agree with Judge Moody on this case either. Assistant Attorney General Ivan Lahner appeared on that July 2nd edition of Byline with Ronald Zobel and briefly outlined the state's contention with Moody's decision.
Well, we think he used an incorrect analysis of the equal protection law and that he did not give enough weight to the legislative purposes and gave too much weight to what the Zobels asserted as their interests. That's in a very general form, and we think he used an incorrect analysis of equal protection law. The cases go in different directions. Justices of the Alaska Supreme Court in individual opinions have gone in different directions. I think, as indicated in some of the news stories of interviews with lawyers around town, and from my personal experience about discussing this case with lawyers around town, you'll get as many opinions as are mathematically possible under the circumstances. Some people think the Supreme Court will uphold the tax, but not the permanent fund. Other people think the reverse. Some people think both will be thrown out. Others think both will be upheld.
That was Assistant Attorney General Ivan Lawner. He heads up the Anchorage office. John, there's speculation that the state wanted a test of these laws. What have you heard regarding that?
Well, the rumor mill has advanced that proposition. I don't believe it to be true.
There was no one out there saying, please, Mr. and Mrs. Zobel, take us to court.
No, I'm quite confident of that. Sometimes there is. When the state is selling bonds, for instance, the buyers of bonds won't act in a doubtful case unless there's been a case that has been brought. In those cases, the case is stimulated. Mm-hmm. Notwithstanding the absence of an invitation, though, this is a major issue. The number of laws in which we've been using durational requirements has been growing, and maybe it is about time we found out how they are going to stand up in court. Let me give you a few of the ones. Many of the members of the public are already familiar with them, but the veterans' loans require 5-year residency. There's 15 years residency requirement for Pioneer's Home, 21 years for longevity bonus. Scholarship forgiveness has a longevity requirement. The homesite entry program, lending of public funds, entry on public lands, the price you pay, all these have these provisions in them, and it could cause administrative havoc if we build a whole empire based on these things without a test.
What's the possibility of this case ultimately ending up in the laps of the U.S. Supreme Court?
Well, if the Supreme Court, our Supreme Court, rules that it is unconstitutional, then they are likely to do so under the state constitution. Mm-hmm. Since the U.S. Supreme Court hears only cases arising under the federal constitution, you're not likely to get an appeal in that case.
There'd be a legislative remedy instead then, probably.
They would be moving to, sure, there's plenty of room for legislative sorting around here. Mm-hmm. Now, on the other hand, if the court upholds the legislation, then the Zobels have a clear right of appeal to the U.S. Supreme Court.
Well, the attorney for the Zobels, Mark Sandberg, says they will go all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court if necessary. During that July 2nd edition of Byline, he was asked about that and how he assesses his chances before the state Supreme Court.
Well, I always tell people I'd rather be the appellee than the appellant. And I think that's the way we have to look at it going in, is I'd rather have won and have someone else have to take it away from me.
Okay. How far are you gentlemen willing to go with this?
We would go to the United States Supreme Court if we had to. There's no question about it. There are legitimate federal questions here that have to be decided sooner or later, and we don't think we'll have to do that. We expect to be vindicated in the Alaska Supreme Court, but if we're not, we would ask the United States Supreme Court to take a look at it.
Sandberg has argued before the state Supreme Court numerous times, but he's never tangled with Av Gross. Gross, the recently resigned Attorney General, and Susan Burke, an Assistant Attorney General, are arguing this case for the state. Sandberg says he's familiar with the way Gross operates in a courtroom since his law partner, Henry Camero, represented Democratic gubernatorial candidate Ed Mertes during the court challenge of the 1978 August primary election. John, one question I have, a resigned Attorney General coming back, why is Gross arguing in this case?
Well, Av Gross may no longer be Attorney General, but he's still Jay Hammond's favorite lawyer. And his presence, along with the presence of the Attorney General staff, is a signal to the court, hey, this is a big one for us, it's really important. It's not a factor that actually persuades the court very much, it's one of those intangible spiritual factors. Also, Av Gross is the guy who went out on the limb with Jay Hammond and said, this, you know, we can make it. We think we've got a good shot at making it with this legislation. The package is at the heart of Jay Hammond's views about the state and economic policy for the state. Av Gross is not going to desert his old friend in his hour of need.
Well, we have a few words from Av Gross. KAKM's Carroll Hodge talked to that gentleman at the Supreme Court chambers yesterday afternoon.
This is your parting shot as Attorney General. Are you glad you're arguing for the state on this particular case?
Yes, I am. I honestly believe that these programs, both of them, the tax repeal and exemption and the permanent fund dividend distribution plan, are constitutionally sound. I've worked on them for a long time. They're difficult questions. I don't suggest that they're simple. but I believe that they are valid, and I'm arguing for the position in which I believe, and in which, in fact, I played a role in developing. The Zobels, of course, believe just as strongly that they are right. I feel a bit sympathetic for the Zobels because I, having been involved in a lot of unpopular causes in my own life, I know that something they never teach you about in law school when they tell you about standing up for the unpopular cause and being one in a group is that it doesn't always provoke the type of response that you read in history books. People don't stand up and say, we disagree with you, but we respect your courage in doing this. They just get mad. And I think the Zobels have obviously touched a nerve in the community. People are angry and upset, but I think it should be clear to everyone in the state that they certainly had the right to bring this suit. They have every sincere belief that they are right. And in the end, it's better for the people of the state that they brought this suit, because somewhere along the line, this program has to be, you know, a court has to put its stamp on it. It is too big and too new not to eventually be tested. And I think the Zobels are, in a strange way, doing a service to everyone by getting the question resolved. And it's certainly, I think, inappropriate for people to be personally angry at them or upset at them. They're doing what every American citizen has the right to do, which is to seek their redress of their own beliefs in court. And I respect them for it, however this comes out.
Governor Jay Hammond has been asked to call a special session of the legislature to deal with the income tax and permanent fund dividend questions. In a recent interview with KAKM, the governor was asked about the state's appeal of Judge Moody's decision and the possibilities of a special session.
I think there's a good chance the Supreme Court will overrule the lower court. They've done so in the past. And we very carefully attempted to structure those bills so that they would be capable of sustaining legal challenge. And most of the legal counsel, in fact, virtually all of the legal counsel that I have talked to, both within and without the government, that I hold in highest regard, has felt there was a good chance that they were sustainable. The income tax, they felt more clearly, was sustainable, since it treated residents and non-residents alike, and that's normal grounds on striking down such issues. The permanent fund dividend concept is totally unprecedented, but since it treats everybody precisely the same during a given year and permits everybody to qualify on par with anybody else, there's a good chance that, too, will be deemed legal by the upper court. I certainly hope it is, because those two programs can inject more into the economy in a quick fix basis for this year that in at a time when it's sorely needed, than any other programs imaginable. It's the equivalent, incidentally, of creating essentially $20,000 a year jobs. Enormous boost to the economy at the time we could use it. Now, we're going to come up with programs that supplant them, but it's back to the drawing board, and they'll be Mickey Mouse in nature and far less capable of providing the bang for the buck into the local economy, I suspect, than the programs that were passed by the legislature.
Governor Hammond was asked why he was hesitant to call a special session of the legislature.
I have said that if the higher court sustains Judge Moody and requires us to reinstitute the income tax, I'd have no hesitation at all at calling a special session. But on the other hand, if they say we're going to put a stay on the reinstitution of the tax, so in essence it's been repealed for everybody, and you can address it then during the coming legislative session, I may or may not call a special session depending on certain other considerations. So I have not closed the door on it by any means. But if it is required, let me say, to continue to provide tax relief on par with what the people have now, you bet I'll call a special session.
John, we have a few minutes before we go to the courtroom, and maybe we can get into briefly the nuts and bolts of today's proceedings. Just how will everything work? Who argues when and how long? And
this isn't an evidentiary case, you understand. It's just argument. And the appellant gets to go first. That's the loser below is the state, and they are the appellant. There will be two counsel arguing for the state, Susan Burke, who's an assistant attorney general and worked with the court system for some time, a very experienced young woman, and, of course, former Attorney General Gross. They'll take 25 minutes apiece. Then we will hear from Mr. Sandberg, the counsel of the Zobels. There'll be a time reserved for rebuttal by
by Mr. Gross, mm-hmm. and I assume he will do the rebuttal himself.
10 minutes at the end.
About 10.
How soon can we expect a decision from the court after today's hearings?
Well, that depends upon how they feel about it. Mm-hmm. When they get through, there'll be an immediate conference of the justices. If they are of one opinion, then they may issue an order within a matter of a very few number of days.
Okay.
If there's disagreement, there'll be circulation of opinions. They are not going to put it to bed until everybody is settled down to exactly what their view is.
Okay. Very briefly, let's go over the justices. We have about a minute and a half, yeah. and let's show people who they are. And first, what about the justices? The chief...
All right. The chief justice is Jay Rabinowitz. He's the senior judge that is now sitting full-time on the court. He'll sit in the middle of the bench and preside over the proceedings. He comes from Fairbanks and served on the Superior Court there.
And then
Justice Burke is the next one shown. He's the fourth ranking in terms of seniority, served earlier as an Anchorage trial judge, and before that was a state prosecutor.
Okay, and then Connor?
Justice Connor. He stands next to Jay Rabinowitz in seniority. He came to the bench yep. from private practice Where's... in Juneau, served earlier in territorial days as a ranking lawyer on the Justice Department and Interior Department.
And Justice Matthews?
Matthews is the most junior justice in age and longevity on the court. Like Burke, he was appointed by Governor Hammond and came from private practice in Anchorage.
Mm-hmm. And Boochever is not really on
Justice
the court
Justice Boochever, we're looking at Justice Boochever now, who will soon be sitting on the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, the intermediate appellate court under the federal system. Because he's about to be sworn in on that court, on this court you will look to see former Justice Diamond sitting in for him, and Justice Diamond will sit just as if he was a regular justice of the court. Mm-hmm. Justice Diamond is kind of an interesting guy. He is one of the original survivors of the three-man court originally appointed, son of Tony Diamond, one of the great figures in Alaska jurisprudence.
Okay, well, we have just a few moments before court proceedings are scheduled to go on. Now, the plan is Susan Burke argues 25 minutes on the income tax, and Avrum Gross, 25 minutes on the permanent fund. We expect a 10-minute break right in there, right?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then Sandberg...
There is a point where even the justices used to sitting must get up and stretch a little.
Okay. Is that the main purpose of it, or is there some...
Mainly, no, it is the time to stretch and get your thoughts reordered and get in shape again.
Okay. Well, we will have that 10-minute break. We predict somewhere about 10 minutes until 11, and then we'll come back to the studio with our expert, and we're ready to go to the court right now. And the justices are walking in. Who's that?
That's Justice Diamond, the senior retired justice.
And we really can't get a look at him from our monitor like this.
Kay Fanning in the foreground there, the editor of the news. Justice Matthews, I believe that was.
I think we'll go.
Good morning. The Supreme Court of Alaska prepared to hear oral argument in the case captioned in part Williams and the State of Alaska versus the Zobels. You'll note that Senior Justice John H. Diamond is sitting with the Supreme Court today under the constitutional authority vested in the office of Chief Justice. I have appointed Justice Diamond to sit with us today. Justice Boochever will take an oath of office as a Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals judge in the federal system next Monday or Tuesday. Are counsel ready to proceed?
We are.
Yes, Your Honor.
Ready, Your Honor.
And who's going to argue first for the Assistant Attorney General Susan Burke.
Thank you, Your Honor. This case really involves two separate enactments that the legislature enacted earlier this year, one providing for a system of graduated tax exemptions and the other providing for distributions of income from the Alaska Permanent Fund. I will be discussing the income tax statute, Avrum Gross, who's with me today, will be discussing the permanent fund distribution plan. Before getting into the reasons why this tax exemption plan is constitutional, I'd like to take a minute to describe how it works. Generally speaking, it provides for a series of graduated exemptions from payment of individual state income taxes. People who are earning income and filing tax returns for the first time don't receive any exemption under the statute and must pay the full amount of their state tax liability. People who have previously filed one return are required to pay only two-thirds of their net tax liability. People who have filed returns in any two previous years, and they don't have to be consecutive years, pays only one-third of net tax liability. And after returns have been filed for any 3 years, people are fully exempt from the tax and are no longer required to file returns. What the legislature has done here, in effect, is to reduce the state income tax by limiting everyone's tax liability to a period of 3 years. There's an additional reduction feature in that during the second and third years of tax liability, a reduced amount must be paid. We believe that the only question before this court is whether the legislature acted reasonably, rationally, and fairly in dealing with the tax relief problem in the way that it did. The Zobels have urged this court to apply a strict scrutiny test because they argue that the statute involves a durational residency requirement and therefore violates their right to travel. But I think it's clear that this statute doesn't impose any sort of durational residency requirement and, in fact, doesn't involve residency at all. New residents haven't been singled out for a tax burden or for the denial of an exemption. The statute simply requires that everyone be subject to the state income tax for 3 years. Many, many non-residents have already qualified for the full tax exemption. Commercial fishermen who've been coming to the state for years, non-resident commercial fishermen who come up seasonally. People who came up to work on the oil pipeline and were here for 3 years, who will undoubtedly be back to help build a gas pipeline, will be fully exempt from taxation under this system. With respect to longer-term residents, young people who are entering the job market for the first time are going to be subject to income tax liability for 3 years, just like a newer resident would be. A subsistence villager who for the first time moves into a cash economy is going to be required, like everyone else, to be subject to the income tax for 3 years. It applies equally to everyone, entirely irrespective of whether a person is a resident, a non-resident, a new resident, or an old resident. It just doesn't make distinctions based on residency.
What's the objective of this tax
measure? There were a number of objectives, Your Honor. One objective, quite obviously, was to provide substantial tax relief, a real tax reduction. At the same time, I think it's quite clear that the legislature did not want the tax to be repealed outright. The legislature believed that people should be required to pay something toward the vast benefits that they receive from state government, and those are the primary ones. And I think if you compare this statute with other state laws that both this court and other courts have found do involve the right to travel, it becomes clear that the right to travel just isn't involved in any way here. It simply isn't an issue.
Well, what if every state had a law like this? Wouldn't that be a very substantial deterrent on interstate migration?
I don't think it would, Your Honor, for a couple of reasons. First of all, I think that kind of analysis, in a sense, may beg the question. If it's legitimate for the legislature, on the one hand, to require persons to contribute something persons who earn income to contribute something toward the costs of state government, and I think that is a legitimate purpose, then I don't see anything wrong with every state doing that. And if you assume that what states are doing or what a legislature is doing by limiting the number of years, it's really a reduced burden on interstate commerce or on migration from state to state.
Well, assume that the instead of the rather benign levels of state income tax that we have now, that the state tax is 50% of earned income after federal taxes. Wouldn't that be just unquestionably a substantial deterrent if every state had such a law to moving from state to state? People couldn't afford to do it.
Well, I think that raises a different question in a sense, and it may raise a something of a due process question,
but
I don't think it relates.
Does constitutionality depend on the tax rate or depend on the principle of
I don't think it depends on the
of
tax
singling
rate.
Out migrants.
I don't think it depends on the tax rate. New migrants wouldn't be singled out, and I think that's really the key question here, singled out under that system. But beyond that, let me say this. As a practical matter, that's never going to happen. It's politically implausible that that would ever happen.
Well, that's the basis for the right of equal treatment. That is, that it's so easy to tax people who aren't members of the constituent majority, and very difficult to apply very burdensome taxes to very many people who have political power. And that's really one of the reasons for the Privileges and Immunities Clause.
But I think you have to remember, too, that that argument assumes that new residents are being singled out here, and they're just not.
Well,
longer
as a practical matter,
longer-term residents.
Isn't it essentially, everyone acknowledges that you can't have a tax law that applies only to non-residents. So that there have been historically various attempts to include a few non-residents in exemptions and tax a few residents. But essentially, what we have is a tax on newcomers, isn't it?
I don't think so at all, Your Honor. There are substantial numbers of non-residents, particularly in Alaska.
How would the percentages break down? Isn't it 80-20 in the record?
I don't think there's anything in the record to that effect.
Isn't there a statement that immediately 80% of the Alaskans would receive tax relief?
I believe one legislator may have made that statement, but I'm not. He certainly didn't have any records in the legislative history to support it, and there's nothing in this record to support that either.
That can't be taken as a factual point that's established either.
I don't.
Really, because one legislator said it in debate doesn't mean that it has any evidentiary.
That it's been precisely.
But when you're talking about Alaskan children having to pay taxes, really isn't that just ridiculously easy to avoid? All the children have to do when they make $1,000 or $1,200 in a summer job is file a return, and then most of that income is going to be excluded anyway, not subject to any substantial tax.
Let me say,
there are very few residents who are actually going to be burdened very seriously by this.
Let me make 2 points about that. First of all, we don't believe, we have no way of knowing at this point because the statute hasn't had time to see how its effects will be applied. But we don't believe that this is going to happen to any sort of significant degree. And even if it did, we don't think that that raises a constitutional problem. I don't think it means that this statute necessarily burdens the right to interstate travel. It may involve something of an over-inclusiveness problem in terms of straight equal protection analysis, but it doesn't necessarily mean that new migrants have been singled out. More importantly, we don't believe or agree with plaintiffs that the legislature intended the law to work that way. If this court believes that this loophole or over-inclusiveness is so broad that it would cause the statute to be unconstitutional, then the court has, I think, really only one option before it. It has to look at the statute and see if it can be construed more narrowly to avoid the over-inclusiveness problem. And this statute clearly can be. I don't think the legislature intended for a resident who had or a non-resident or anybody who had never before been subject to taxation to get the exemptions by going down to the lobby of the Westward Hotel and selling a button to someone else for 25 cents. I think what they intended was, and I think it's a reasonable construction of the statute, that a person is entitled to the exemption under the statute if they are required, under the tax law, required to file a return. In other words, if they have the minimum amount of income that would subject them to the statute's filing requirement, that's AS 4320.030. And I think that if this looks like a problem, that is the answer to it. The other thing in terms of the durational residency cases, two points that I'd like to make here. One is that this is very different from any of the durational residency cases that have come before the U.S. Supreme Court or before this court. One example would be the Van Dort case, the voting case. In that case, Mr. Van Dort was denied the right to register to vote. He had met every single requirement, every qualification that longer-term residents had met who were permitted to register. The only difference was the length of residency, the only difference. And that's true when you go through all of those cases. There's a substantial difference here, and it's a real difference, between a person who newly arrives in the state who doesn't receive a full tax exemption and a person who may have been here longer who does. And that is, that person has been subject to state income tax liability for 3 years. It's not a durational residency requirement. Furthermore, we don't think the disproportionate impact analysis is really appropriate in a durational residency case. It's certainly never been applied in a durational residency right to travel case that I've ever seen. Cases that the plaintiff relied on involved racial discrimination, not just a suspect classification, but one that, because of the nature of race as a classification, and because of the incredible history of discrimination against racial minorities in this country over the years, has required the application of a special sort of doctrine, the disproportionate impact doctrine. We don't think that's appropriate here. Furthermore, even if those cases applied here, the plaintiffs haven't met their burden. Those cases require that the plaintiff or the challenger prove that there's a disproportionate impact. And they haven't done that here. There's nothing in the record. They've simply made assertions that it might work this way. Furthermore, if you really think about it, there isn't a disproportionate impact here at all. If you look at a single year and you look at one person who may be subject to the tax and another who hasn't, yeah, it might look a little bit like there is a disproportionate impact. But what that fails to recognize is that the person who isn't paying taxes isn't paying taxes because they've already borne the impact. The impact isn't disproportionate over the long term. It applies to everyone. In summary, we don't believe there's any reasonable way that this case can be characterized as a durational residency case or a right to travel case. Legislative motives have been asserted here as proof that the legislature intended to discriminate against new residents. But I think if you read the House debates carefully, I don't think that's really what was happening here at all. But more important, this court has always cautioned that the individual remarks, particularly in floor debates of legislators, really shouldn't be relied upon to prove the intent of the entire legislative body. Three or four people who made individual remarks compared with 60 members of the legislature. I don't think that meets a burden of proof either in terms of improper motivation. We think the only question in this case is whether this statute meets the substantial relationship requirement. And we believe that it clearly does. The purposes of the three-year filing limitation, tax liability limitation, include several interrelated, and I want to stress interrelated, purposes. On the one hand, the legislature clearly wanted to provide substantial tax relief. On the other hand, it's also quite clear that they did not want to repeal the income tax outright immediately for everyone. They wanted to retain the tax as a source of revenue. In part, we believe they wanted to avoid, to some extent.
You can't justify distinctions made in a revenue statute because of the desire for revenue. I mean, if you could do that, you could justify a law that said everyone whose name began with A will be taxed and the rest of you are scot-free.
Well, let me talk about the other purposes that may relate more directly to the so-called distinction. I mean, it's really a limitation on tax liability. And in a sense, it's difficult even to think about distinctions because it really does apply to everyone. In a given moment of time, one person may be subject to the tax and another not. But it's not a distinction over the long term. But in any event, looking at outright repeal and the effects of outright repeal, the legislature was concerned about a kind of inequity that would inhere to taxpayers who have been shouldering the tax, the income tax, for all these years since statehood, as against those who would be earning income in the future, receiving substantial benefits from the state for which they paid nothing simply because now the state can afford a substantial tax reduction. We're not saying that this sense of inequity would rise to constitutional proportions, certainly not. But I think that it is clear that that was something of the legislature's motivation or purpose here, and that this statute does at least provide a measure of parity over the long term between people who will be earning income from Alaska sources, whether residents or non-residents in the future, and those who have been subject to the tax burden for a substantial period of time. Finally.
Isn't that argument, though, expressly rejected by Mr. Justice Brennan in the Shapiro case? He discusses that argument.
I don't think it is specifically rejected. If you read that statement very carefully, all it says is that equal protection wouldn't allow us to do this. It doesn't say that that's an improper purpose. And the reasons that equal protection wouldn't permit a state to distinguish between who gets welfare benefits and who doesn't on the basis of length of residency is because length of residency isn't rationally related to the purposes behind providing welfare. In this statute, the relationship is there. That's the difference. Furthermore, and I think one of the other important purposes is to require persons in the future who earn Alaska-based income to contribute something toward the costs of the vast benefits that this state provides them, which incidentally, many of which really relate quite directly, as we pointed out in our brief, to income earning as an activity. The Zobels have argued that this really can't be substantially related because some people won't have enough income to actually generate tax liability. What they're really saying is that the statute may be over-inclusive as to that purpose. But this court in a Pocket Act made it very clear that a statute does not violate equal protection because it may be slightly over-inclusive, because some persons might suffer inequity from it. And that's all we're talking about in this case. Furthermore, I think another point on the Zobels make much of the fact that if the legislature had really wanted to make people contribute to the state, they would have required in the statute that some amount of tax have been paid. To really think about that, it wouldn't have made any sense. You take, for example, two people with equal amounts of gross income, and one has sufficient deductions, credits, and so forth under the tax laws to bring his or her tax liability down to zero. The other person doesn't. The other person would be entitled to claim the exemption. The person who claimed all of the exemptions and so forth wouldn't. And if you required the payment of some tax, you get some absurd results. People would not claim exemptions to which they were legally entitled, simply to have end up with a dollar's worth of tax contribution. And I think you have to remember and keep in mind that the legislature wanted to keep intact the progressive income tax. And that's what they've done, and that's how a progressive income tax works. Some differences may result in the amount of tax that people pay, but there's no discrimination involved because of that. In summary, we believe that the legislature has acted totally rationally, totally properly, in providing income tax relief in this way. We're talking about a number of interrelated and, in some senses, some competing purposes, all of which the legislature wanted to try to deal with in some way. The statute doesn't discriminate against new residents. Everyone is subject to income tax liability for 3 years. Furthermore, to the extent that a new resident might feel a burden, in a sense, from being subject to the tax for 3 years, I think you need to remember that whatever burden they think they have, it's been reduced by the legislature and reduced substantially. People are only going to have to pay the tax for a short period of time, for 3 years. Finally, the Zobels in this case have the burden of demonstrating that this statute is unconstitutional. There's a presumption of constitutionality here. And they can't meet that burden by mere assertions that they're second-class citizens, that they've been discriminated against, that this is unfair. If you apply the equal protection principles that this court has announced, we believe this statute clearly meets those tests and doesn't deny equal protection to anyone.
May it please the court. The second part of this case concerns a unique program called the Permanent Fund Dividend Distribution Plan, by which some of the wealth generated by the development of Alaska's oil resources is returned directly to Alaska's residents. Everything about this case is somewhat unique. Nothing quite like it has ever come before a court of this nation before. And because it is so unusual, I want to spend just a moment, by way of introduction, discussing some of the background of the dividend plan. The permanent fund itself, of course, was created several years ago through constitutional amendment. It was created for varying reasons, but the most important was to ensure that money from the development of limited amounts of oil wealth that someday ran out, would run out, but which nonetheless belonged to all Alaskans, would not be used exclusively or worse yet, be wasted by any one particular group of Alaska residents. The permanent funds is a savings account against that inevitable day when the oil will run out. And the money to run the state has to come from some source. It is, in essence, a plan to ensure that there will be money available at that time. Now, none of the principle of the permanent fund may be appropriated by the legislature, but the income, which is a sustained resource and recurs each year, may be appropriated. Because the income is substantial and will get more so, concerns have arisen or arose in this particular political time that it would be wasted in costly or unnecessary government programs while the majority of Alaskans receive no tangible benefit from it. Now, that's a concern which is talked about a great deal in every state today. Government growth and expansion is on everyone's mind. But in Alaska, we have a unique twist to this particular problem. In most states, government growth is controlled by the method of taxation. To spend money for new programs, the legislature has to raise taxes on the people. That's a political debit to balance the credit of new programs. But here, the legislature can do what it wants without raising new taxes. They can just sell oil leases and either not put the money in the permanent fund and use it for government, or they can put the money in the permanent fund and take the interest and use it for government. Now, theoretically, oil revenues, just like tax revenues, belong to the residents of the state who pay them. But their interest in oil revenues is much less direct. People don't tend to think of it as their money. They think of it as the state's money. The Permanent Fund Dividend Distribution Plan was created for the basic purpose of making the link between residents of the state and the oil wealth which they own direct. It returns directly to them some of the interest on the revenues produced through oil development. Now, if the legislature wants to use oil money and not put it in the permanent fund or use interest from the permanent fund, it will have a direct impact on the amount of money people will receive each year. There's an alternative provided. Either the people receive more dividends or they receive different government programs. It's the same kind of choices you face when the legislature decides whether to raise taxes or not. Put it another way, the dividend distribution plan imposes a direct political control on the use of oil money by giving people a personal stake in how those funds are spent. Now, the specific plan chosen by the legislature to distribute dividends is as follows. One half of the interest of the permanent fund is distributed to the residents of the state each year. Each resident of the state, immediately upon becoming a resident, receives rights to participate in the plan from the moment they arrive. The annual dividend is exactly the same for everyone. And the rights to accumulate dividends under the program, for accumulation is permitted, is exactly the same for every resident. Now, every resident of the state receives different amounts of dividends at any one particular point in time, since dividends are cumulative. But they all have the same rights to achieve that cumulative amount as they live through their residency in the state. Over time, and because this is a long-term program, dispensing dividends over time, it's impossible to say how much in total any particular resident will receive. If they live here a long time, it will be a substantial amount. If they leave after a short time, it will be very little. But their legal rights to participate in the plan are exactly the same as any other residents of the state. Now, of course, the plaintiffs don't see the plan as one in which they have equal rights with all other Alaskans. To them, this plan, in effect, and they describe it as this, is an effort to benefit old-time residents of Alaska at the expense of new residents of Alaska. And as in their argument on the income tax, the plaintiffs rely on a series of cases in which states have refused to provide benefits like medical care or welfare or the vote to new residents for some period of time. They claim that like the new residents in those cases, that this statute singles them out for special treatment because they have specially moved here, that it denies them benefits or rights available to all other Alaskans, and that it, in essence, makes them what they call second-class citizens. Now, if the plaintiffs are correct, of course, there's a very serious constitutional problem. Now, the right to travel freely between states is a fundamental right which has been recognized by this court, and even if it hadn't, by the United States Supreme Court. States may not put up barriers against new residents, either directly, as some states tried to do during the Depression, or subtly, by denying new residents benefits available to all residents, all other residents of the state. It's established beyond any question that states may not condition the right to travel by imposing prohibitions only on new residents, people who have recently moved to a state, or by forcing a person who moves to a state for the first time to choose between his right to freely migrate and his right to exercise some right available to all other citizens of the state. But that's not the situation in this case. This case has nothing to do with interstate migration. Whatever distinctions are made in this law, they are not named at new residents. All Alaskans are treated exactly the same. All receive exactly the same rights. All receive exactly the same annual dividend and the same rights to accrue dividends. And at any one time, all residents who have lived in Alaska, not just new versus old, for different periods